Anyway, we're listening for birds that have arrived. Yolo, meanwhile, has been out trying to find a bird that's about to make a dramatic departure.
I've come to Skooma, a small, rugged island less than half a mile off the southwest coast of Wales.
I'm hoping to witness one of the most spectacular events on the island's calendar, the mass fledging of one of Britain's most remarkable birds.
A third of the Manx shearwater global population come to this small island to breed. The adults left 2 or 3 weeks ago on their migration, but what about the chicks?
Might be hard to believe, but there could be as many as 200,000 Manx shearwater chicks here on Skooma at this very moment. They're underground in their burrows, and the reason that they stay out of sight by day is because of these large gulls patrolling the skies.
To find out more about how they survive, I'm meeting up with my old friend Tim Guilford, who's dedicated his life to studying these birds.
It's like a bit of Swiss cheese, isn't it, underground here?
It gets very fragile at the end of the season, and all the burrows.
Tim recently tracked several adult shearwaters all the way to Patagonia, a distance of over 7,000 miles. Evidence suggests that the chicks undertake the same mammoth journey.
Come on.
How old is this one then, Tim?
I think he's about 65 days since hatching. You can see he's just, he or she, just starting to lose the remains of the down.
Yeah.
So his parents will have stopped feeding this bird now. They'll have abandoned it and hopefully has enough fat reserves to make that flight straight to South America.
Many birds follow their parents on their first migration, but this young shearwater will have to navigate to the far side of the globe alone. After the chick has been ringed and weighed, Tim carefully returns it to its burrow. It's late afternoon and Skooma is eerily quiet. It's amazing to think that just beneath my feet are thousands of hungry chicks waiting for the right conditions to leave the safety of their burrows.
These chicks fledge over several nights, but according to Tim, tonight's the night when it all comes to a head. There's very little moon, so it's going to be incredibly dark, and the chicks need this darkness to get off the island safely. And because they require the darkness, we're not going to be using torches. We're going over to night vision.
Tim is taking me to one of the highest places on the island, where he thinks we'll get our best view of the departing birds.
To see,
it looks like I've timed my visit to perfection.
Here we go. Oh, wow, look at
there's
that.
There's loads of them.
Loads of them.
Now, these are in the bracken. We wouldn't normally be able to see that. They're coming out of the burrows.
Oh, they are. Look, they're all birds.
That's brilliant.
Wow.
Minute by minute, more and more shearwaters emerge from underground. Since the adults left, the youngsters have been burning off their fat and developing their wing muscles. They're finally ready for their maiden flight. But they need to get as high as possible to give them the best chance of making it off the island.
And a lot of birds starting to climb up the rocks. You've actually got one on your head. I've known you a long time. I've never seen you look quite so foolish, I have to say.
Clearly, they see us not as a threat, but as an extension of the rock face. And soon, we're covered in them.
It's the first time I've ever been a climbing frame for Manx shearwaters. And I've got to tell you, it's a very unique experience. Here comes another one now. Stop squabbling. Oh, yes, I know. Go on then, up you go. Be gentle.
With this modern camera technology, it's easy to forget that neither we nor the shearwaters can see anything at all. But boy, are they making their presence felt.
This one has got very sharp claws. I'm going to put my hand underneath it. Ah. Oh, that's better. You've got more hair than I have. They're quite argumentative too, aren't they? The whole purpose of this, of course, is for these birds to gain height. They try to get the best possible vantage point for launching themselves off. They have to clear the vegetation here, they have to clear the rocks, they need to clear the breakers to get out to the open sea before first light. If they can do that, they've got a chance for survival. It's a huge transition for them, isn't it?
It is, and they'll come back to breed here in about 5 years' time, most of them, the ones that survive.
For the next hour, a procession of eager shearwaters stream over our bodies and take the plunge. It may be a surreal experience for me, but it's a crucial moment in the lives of these young birds.
This might look quite comical, but these are remarkable birds. They're leaving their burrows for the first time. They're now going to launch themselves off out into the open ocean. They have no map, they have nobody to guide them, and yet they're going to make it all the way down to southern Argentina. There goes one now. It's an amazing journey for a remarkable bird.
They certainly are remarkable birds, but that is a really harsh launch into independence. I mean, Chris, imagine if they were teenagers. Mm-hmm. You know, they're left at home on their own, they're not given mm-hmm. any food, mm-hmm. not even given a forwarding address, and they're expected to get out of security mm-hmm. in the middle of the night and fly thousands of miles without any parental guidance.
Which is exactly what happened to me. I just bought myself a microwave and everything sorted itself out, to be quite honest with you. But no, it is. They're out there now, somewhere in the Atlantic, in the dark, in the cruel sea. Can you imagine those little birds out there?
Well, it's interesting, isn't it? Because it's still a bit of a mystery where those chicks go. But it's thought that they do follow their parents and go down to Brazil and Argentina. And it's also thought that they don't stop to feed.
Until they get
there. They go all that way on their reserve of fat.
That's like
incredible migration.
Not eating all the way to shop for the microwave and then bringing it back home and only then putting something in it.
Oh, life's tough, isn't it, Chris?
It is indeed. Last night, we launched our migration watch in conjunction with the RSPB. And we asked you to look out for three different types of birds: redwings, bramblings and waxwings. Well, we've had reports in from the strangest of places, including the North Sea Bird Club. One gentleman, Lenny Simpson, is on Curlew at the oil platform, and he saw two redwing. Another one, Jeff Barry, he works here. Here's a picture of where Jeff works. This is the Alba rig, and he too has been spotting redwings. Take a look at this. Here's one perched on the platform. But Jeff has also had a merlin on his oil rig, and this predatory falcon has been out there eating all of the redwings too.
Oh, no!
What about that? Now, look, let's have a look at this, Michaela. We've got a map here, which we like. Would you hold that for me? Mm-hmm. Here we are. We've got the oil rigs out here. They're about 200 or 130 miles, one of those, out into the North Sea. They're like our migration early warning system, if you like. And then around the coast, we've got our bird observatories. We rang them up today to see what they had. What have we got? Paul Collins at Spurn Head Bird Observatory had 92 hooper swans. They arrived yesterday, no red wings. Kevin Smith at Gibraltar Point Bird Observatory, he's down here, he had 4,000 wood pigeons today.
Great.
Thanks, Kevin. Thanks very much indeed. But what about you? Well, yes, you've been in touch too. Each one of these dots represents a different species. Firstly, the yellow one, waxwing. The sexiest of all of those birds. One of these spotted up here off the coast of Scotland. Oh, and another one here, look, in the what looks like the East Midlands. Then, of course, the black ones, these are bramblings, and these have moved inland already. These birds are going to be feeding on beech mast. They're a forest species, so they've moved away from the coast. And then lastly, the redwings. And look, already these redwings are all the way down into the West Country. So they've and one over here in Ireland too. But do keep your reports coming if you spot any of these birds, waxwings, bramblings and redwings. And you can contact us via the website, that's bbc.co.uk/autumnwatch, or you can tweet us and use the hashtag migration watch. Keep it up, because by the end of the week we'd like to see a lot more reports, and I'd like to see a lot more waxwings.
Chris, you know the storm has obviously slowed a lot of them up, mm-hmm. and some of them have stopped for a few days. Does that mean in a few days' time we're going to get masses of them and it's going to be a real spectacle?
We're thinking perhaps towards the end of the week, but you do get these surges. If the winds are in the wrong direction for a sufficient period, all of these, particularly the smaller birds that won't fight against those winds, will just wait. And they'll carry on weight and their numbers will build up, and then all of a sudden you get a massive, what we call a fall of them. So many come over, they appear to drop out of the skies the minute they find the land. And that could be very exciting if conditions persist.
Great week for bird watchers.
Could
then.
Be at the end of the week.
But it's not just birds that are migrating, many other animals do as well, including fish. And for some fish, the Northwest is a bit of a hotspot. couple of days ago, one of our wildlife cameramen went to film just locally on the River Kent, only a little way away from where we are right now. Now, he was filming this lovely scenic shot when suddenly he spotted this. If you look closely, there's a salmon. Now, these salmon are migrating upstream. They've come from the North Atlantic. They've gone through the Irish Sea into the river via Morecambe Bay. And just look at them. When they leap, they have huge obstacles to cross. And just like the Manx shearwater, they do that river migration without eating.
Amazing. But why would you do all of that? You've got to have a good reason. And the good reason for these fish is quite simple. They've gone there to breed. This is what it's all about. They run silent, they run deep, they go all the way up to the shallows. And here, they form what is called a red. And they're using their tails to move these pebbles so that they create a shallow depression in the bottom of the river. The female there deposits the eggs, the males fertilise them, and they use the gravel because there's plenty of water flowing through it, and that keeps the eggs well oxygenated. And of course, they lay lots of eggs in each of those reds. Now, eggs are tasty, as we all know, so there are things which are there to either eat the eggs or the things that hatch out of them. And one of the things we spotted on the river is this, the dipper. Now, whether they take salmon eggs or not, I'm not entirely sure. I wouldn't put it past them, but one bird that certainly takes salmon fry, i.e. developing fish, small ones, is this, the goosander. A lovely bird. This is a female. Hops into the river there, and look at the way it peers beneath the surface, looking out for its prey. It will then dive down and catch fish, and it's got a serrated edge to its beak so it doesn't lose its grip when they're a bit slippery.
I wonder how many make it. You know,
the salmon.
Yeah, the salmon.
Well, very few, but I mean, they do lay lots of eggs. Sometimes they don't all die. They will make it back, despite the fact they get into very poor condition because they're not eating and their immune system suffers. But sometimes the salmon get a second chance, they come up and breed again, but they lay thousands of eggs.
And once those eggs have hatched, they stay in the river for 2 years. They go through a transformation and turn into smolts. And it's at that point that they need to go from the freshwater back to the seawater, so they migrate back again. And they do that through Morecambe Bay. Now, Morecambe Bay really is a remarkable place for wildlife, of course, not just the salmon, but the wading birds as well. And a couple of days ago, I took my binoculars down there to really enjoy the spectacle. Morecambe Bay is a magnet for wading birds from all over the world. Local ornithologist Pete Marsh is on hand to help me identify a few of the more common species.
Oyster catchers are fairly easy, black and white, obviously, red eye, red beak.
Yes, the oyster catchers are very much an international group because in the same flock of even just 10 birds, you may have one from the Faroe Islands, one from Iceland, one from Norway, one from the Shetlands, one from North Scotland, and maybe one from just the local river valleys. They'll all get together in one flock in winter.
The large tidal range at Morecambe exposes a vast mud buffet. It's an ideal stop-off for these well-travelled hungry birds.
Now, what about the knots? They're the rather dumpy grey and white birds, aren't they? Very small.
Dumpy grey and white birds, very difficult to sell in inverted commas if you just have one on its own. The big spectacle with knots is when they get together.
Wow.
There's about 5,500 in that lot.
5,500 birds in the sky doing their beautiful bird ballet.